He spent almost 40 years in and around the restaurant industry. He's been an owner and an operator. He's a member of the Colorado Restaurant Hall of Fame. The last quarter of a century, his radio shows have been keeping you updated on the ever-changing Colorado restaurant scene, where he invites you to join him, both on the air and for meals at area restaurants. He's Mike Boyle, and this is The Restaurant Show.
Let's get it on. It's 11:06, and we are back for the second hour of the Restaurant Show here on News Talk 710 KNUS in Denver and in Colorado Springs, AM 1460 and FM 101.1. The Answer. It is Sunday, September 16th. It is the day that the Broncos take on the Oakland Raiders at 2:25 this afternoon at Bronco Stadium at Mile High. I know that many of us will be following that game. Also this afternoon at 2 o'clock, the Rockies take on the San Francisco Giants. And I'm going to make a pretty bold prediction here. I'm going to predict that the Rockies will at least score today. The last two games against the Giants, they have been shut out. But, hey, good pitching will always stop good hitting. We've got plenty of good hitters. Let's hope that our pitching staff, you know what, they got beat, well, 2-0 and 3-0, so it's not like our pitching staff hasn't done a good job. But we just haven't been able to score any runs. So it's a big day in Colorado sports, and hopefully it will come out with two wins, one for the Rockies and one for the Broncos. We're taking your calls, 303-696-1971. In the first hour, talked a little bit about the Red Hen restaurant in Lexington, Virginia, and how the town is now putting emergency funds into tourism spending because the publicity that they got because of that screwball in a restaurant running Sarah Sanders off has had a devastating effect. Now, you think also maybe you might want to talk, we talked about this a little bit last week, you think maybe the signing, you know, I don't know if you've heard this. Have I told you how much I love Donald Trump? I love this guy as president. I love this guy. Does he have some rough edges? Yeah, don't we all? But I'm telling you what, I love this guy. But I have to tell you something. His economy is so good that even Colin Kaepernick was able to get a job. We missed the rim shot there. Boom, boom. Anyway, last week, of course, Nike announced that they had signed Colin Kaepernick to be an endorser or the face of their new ad campaign. And so I mentioned that their stock fell 3%, which is $50 million or something like that. And Chuck called from Highlands Ranch, and he said, yeah, but they had a big day of sales, and sales are rebounding and so forth and so on. So I did a little research on this, and this is from Fortune magazine. They do a pretty good job with this stuff. Nike stock fell 3% on Colin Kaepernick's endorsement deal. Here's why investors in Nike, of course, will shrug it off. All right, 3% was probably about $50 million. If you multiply it out, you can imagine the value of the company like Nike's. Nike's shares fell 3.2% on Tuesday as investors weighed whether the company's endorsement deal with Colin Kaepernick would slow its stock bull run in the past year. From the looks of things, that is unlikely. The swoosh, which is what they call it, is unlikely to go out of style with investors. Nike weighed into the controversy surrounding Kaepernick that began when in 2016 he took a knee during the national anthem played at a football game. Donald Trump has kept the controversy at full boil with his tweets on the subject. Nike has largely been quiet but used the Just Do It campaign to show its siding with those who kneel. I'm going to share this a little bit more with you when we come back, but if you've got any thoughts, I'd love to hear from you. 303-696-1971. We'll be back with The Restaurant Show on AM 1460 and...
You know, for years I've been singing the praises of the India's Castle Restaurant at 9555 East Arapahoe Road, just east of I-25. Locally owned and operated. As for Jay, Jay's the owner. Tell him I sent you. He's a great, great guy. You can go in for lunch. They've got a great lunch buffet. Chicken curry, spinach saag paneer. They've got the basmati rice, salads, soups, a nice lentil soup. They've got wonderful, wonderful food. Or you can go in for dinner and you can enjoy some of the curries. You can enjoy some of the vegetarian items, some of the saag dishes, some of the vindaloos. It is wonderful, wonderful food. And another thing that I really like about the India's Castle at 9555 East Arapahoe Road, they are open 365 days a year. And that makes a big difference because sometimes you're an empty nester. Sometimes there's a holiday going on. You don't know if a place is going to be open. India's Castle is open for lunch and dinner 365 days a year. 9555 East Arapahoe Road. And tell them you heard about it from me on The Restaurant Show.
If you're looking for some great food, great burgers, salads, a fabulous Reuben sandwich, and even a few Mexican dishes, and if you're looking for a nice, lively gathering place with a fun bar and neighborhood feel, then leave your office and visit the office of Mike Hernandez, who has operated restaurants in the Denver metro area for years. Confused? Well, the name of the place is The Office Kitchen and Bar, and it's located at 230 3rd Street, right next to the old stone church in downtown Castle Rock. It's a casual place, a place where you can hang out and relax, but that doesn't mean that the food isn't good. Mike has been in the restaurant business for years, recently owning the Blue Nectar Mexican Grill in Castle Rock until he was able to move into this beautiful new space. That's why he's also included his fish tacos, the carnitas platter, and a couple of other dishes people came to enjoy at the old place. But the office kitchen is different. It's new. It's fun. So stop by and check it out. The kitchen even offers one of the largest selections of bourbons in the area. Burgers, bourbons, and beers. What more could you need? The office in Castle Rock.
Hey, everybody, it's Mike, and you know I've got a dog now. Well, actually, it's my daughter's dog. She adopted a street dog down in Mexico. It's a great dog. His name is Bailey, and she was a little concerned about him, so we brought him up to the United States. We brought him up to the good old Estados Unidos, and he lives with me in Castle Rock while she's figuring out what she wants to do. But the dog, when he got here, you know how sometimes when you go to Mexico, your tummy gets a little upset? Well, when he came to the United States, his tummy got a little upset, and I thought, my God, this guy has actually ruined two rooms worth of carpets. I didn't know what to do. I called Mike Bagnall, B-A-G-N-A-L-L, Bagnall Carpet and Upholstery Cleaning, 303-797-6400. He came on out. I said, Mike, do I need a new carpet? He said, Mike, we will get that taken care of. And they did an amazing job. If you need your carpets cleaned, call Bagnall, B-A-G-N-A-L-L, 303-797-6400. And tell them you heard about it from Mike Boyle on The Restaurant Show.
Minutes after 11 o'clock here in The Restaurant Show. So Nike stock fell 3% on Colin Kaepernick's endorsement deal. Here's why investors will shrug it off. This is from Fortune magazine. A 3% decline in one day is nothing to ignore, but there are several reasons to believe that the social media images of people burning their Nike shoes in their well-manicured backyards or taking scissors to the black swooshes on their socks won't intimidate Nike investors in the long run. The first reason is that bull run. Even with Tuesday's decline, Nike stock is up more than 50% in the past year and up 134% in the past 5 years. Don't you wish you bought 5 years ago? Investors will sit back during the controversy, but they never want to sit out a bull rally. The reason for that persistent rally is that Nike shows the power of its brand. According to Interbrand, Nike is the world's 18th most valuable brand behind tech giants like Facebook and Apple, but ahead of many other companies involved in any other company involved in fashion and retail clothing. In addition, listen to this. Nike's current growth is coming from markets that simply don't care about whether football players take a knee during the U.S. national anthem. Nike's U.S. revenues in the past quarter fell 5% in the last 9 months. That was well before it took a side in the kneeling debate. At the same time, however, it grew 8% in Latin America, 13% in Europe, and 16% in China. And you can imagine what that market must be doing. Consumers in these companies may know about who kneels in American football, but few will care. Long-term investors know how Nike weighs growth against its social impact. If anything seems off about this partnership with Kaepernick, it's that it's taken so long for Nike to choose a side. How does a company celebrate 30 years of Just Do It by telling a premier athlete he probably shouldn't have done something he just did out of passion? The article concludes by saying there's also a question of whether or how well consumer boycotts work. The evidence is mixed, but suggests that they are more potent when a group of loyal customers complain. For now, ashen shoes and trimmed white socks are bad PR for Nike, but the company's management seems to have weighed the risk of such a boycott and decided it would be better off weathering whatever storm it brings. And I mention this because my daughter, you know, I've been on the air for 27 plus years in Denver, which means that many of you have grown up with her figuratively on the air. 23 years in Colorado Springs. She's a tremendous athlete, and she knows what she wants. She knows what she needs to compete at a high level of triathlons or swimming events or whatever she happens to be doing. She wears Nikes, and we talked about it. And you know what? She's going to continue to wear a Nike. Do I think that players should protest by kneeling during the national anthem? No. Do I think that probably 90% of them don't even know or can articulate why they are kneeling? Probably. But you know what? There's about 3,000, that's the number that I've been told, active boycotts against different companies throughout the United States at any time during the year, and most of them you never hear about. Now, the boycott Nike hashtag that came out got some immediate response, and then all of a sudden it just kind of withered. So I thought it was interesting. By the time you take Latin America, Europe, and China, and those numbers and the way they've increased, Nike can probably weather a little dip in the North American market. Love to hear from you. 303-696-1971. 303-696-1971. All right. Now, you know I love Mexico, right? I love Mexico almost as much as I love Donald Trump. But I know that a lot of you get real nervous. You know, you walk down the 16th Street Mall in Denver and you're going to see a cop, right? All right, you drive down Tejon Street in Colorado Springs, there's probably going to be a cop car somewhere around Acacia Park, right? But people think that Mexico is completely out of control. When you see a policeman in Mexico, you get nervous. You think, oh, my God, there must be the cartel must be around here or whatever. Well, Mexico's economy, after petroleum, the second highest provider of hard currencies, foreign currencies, is tourism. So they are doing everything they can to protect it. Was it tragic that a CU student trying to protect his mother from robbery in Puerto Vallarta 3, 4, 5 years ago was shot and killed? Of course, but it's not the norm. My daughter lives down there, for crying out loud. I go down there and wander all over the place. Now, I'm not out at the clubs at 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm sleeping. But and you know what your mother said about midnight anyway. Nothing good happens after it. But there's a restaurant in Denver, 3298 South Broadway, called Garibaldi Mexican Bistro. And I went in, and they've taken the convenience store part of a gas station and converted it into a little Mexican. I think bistro is a little strong. I think of a bistro as a bit more upscale. It's very industrial. It's very utilitarian. But at any rate, they got another location down at 12th and Broadway. I have not been there. Maybe what I'm going to do is go down and have a meal at Cap City, which Steve recommended in the first hour, but stop over and see Garibaldi. When I was talking to the owners, I said, where does the name Garibaldi come from? I mean, you think of Garibaldi, doesn't that sound Italian to you? All right. They said, well, you know, it's the name of a beautiful plaza in Mexico City, where the street vendors go and where people gather. It's kind of like this gigantic, if you've ever been to Mexico City, it's huge. It's one of the largest cities in the world, 20 million, whatever it is. But it's like, I love to go to different places and go to flea markets or farmers markets, whatever you want to call them, because it really gives you a feel for the community. We just got back from Banff. My daughter and I were up in Banff. We went hiking. We went all over the place. And one day we were up on this mountain. We had hiked to the top of this mountain. We looked down on the town, I said, that's got to be a farmer's market. That's got to be a flea market. She said, do you think that's what it is?